Hello everyone, myself Dr. Varsha from Department of Community Medicine. I welcome you all to the e-lecture series of Community Medicine. Today I will be talking about medical entomology. The learning objectives are, at the end of this lecture, you should be able to define medical entomology, give classification of arthropods of medical importance. You should know various arthropod borne diseases along with the vectors responsible for transmitting these diseases. Give general principles of arthropod control. You should know life history of mosquito. Identify and differentiate between three genus of mosquitoes and give various control measures of mosquitoes. Starting with the introduction, we'll see some of the definitions. First one is entomology, which is the branch of science dealing with the study of insects. Then medical entomology, which is the study of arthropods of medical importance. For example, study of mosquitoes, houseflies, louse, which are responsible for transmission of various arthropod borne diseases. Now, what are these arthropods? The arthropods are small creatures having jointed legs, absence of vertebrae, and bilateral symmetrical body consisting of segments. The arthropods transmit the diseases either directly by acting as parasite or indirectly by acting as vectors or carriers of the disease. Now, what are the vectors? So, vector, it is an arthropod which is a carrier of disease causing organism. For example, mosquito in case of malaria. The vector, it can be mechanical or biological vector. The mechanical vector means the arthropod which passively directly transmit the pathogen without biting. For example, housefly. Or the vector can be biological, where the arthropod transmits the pathogen indirectly by biting the reservoir or sucking the blood. Then comes the arthropod-borne or vector-borne diseases. These are the diseases which are transmitted by arthropods. For example, malaria, dengue, chikungunya, etc. Actually, we are concerned about vector-borne diseases, which are major public health problems in the developing countries and are one of the leading causes of morbidity and mortality. To combat these diseases, we have to control the vectors. And to ensure the effective control of these vectors, the knowledge about their life cycle, habits, habitat, and diseases transmitted is essential, which we are going to study in medical entomology, which is the study of arthropods of medical importance. First of all, we'll see the various types of transmission of arthropod-borne diseases, which has been already covered in epidemiology. But just to revise, there are three types of transmission of these diseases. First one is direct contact, second one mechanical transmission, and third one is biological transmission. In direct contact, the arthropods are directly transferred from man to man through close contact. For example, each mite in case of scabies and louse in case of pediculosis. Then in mechanical transmission, the disease agent is transmitted mechanically by the arthropod. Means the arthropods just carry the organism on their body or in the gut. For example, transmission of gastrointestinal diseases by housefly. Then biological transmission, where the disease agent multiplies or undergoes some of the developmental changes with or without multiplication in arthropod host. Again, there are three subtypes of biological transmission. First one is propagative, then cyclopropagative, and cyclodevelopmental. In propagative biological transmission, the disease agent only multiplies in the body of the vector without undergoing any cyclical change. For example, plague bacilli in rat flea. Then, in case of cyclopropagative biological transmission, the disease agent undergoes cyclical changes and multiplies in the body of the arthropod. For example, malaria parasite in Anopheline mosquito. And in case of cyclodevelopmental biological transmission, there occurs only developmental changes without multiplication. For example, filarial parasite in Culex mosquito. Now coming to the classification of arthropods of medical importance. The phylum Arthropod consists of three important classes: class Insecta, class Arachnida, and class Crustacea. In class Insecta comes mosquitoes, flies, human lice, fleas, and reduvid bug. Class Arachnida consists of ticks and mites. And class Crustacea, there is only one member, which is Cyclops. The distinctive features of the arthropods are: in class Insecta, the body is divided into head, thorax, and abdomen. And in case of Arachnida and Crustacea, the body is divided into two parts, that is cephalothorax and abdomen. Class Insecta has three pairs of legs. In class Arachnida bears four pairs, while class Crustacea bears five pairs of legs. In case of class Insecta, there is one pair of antenna. In class Crustacea, two pairs of antenna, and class Arachnida, no antenna. The class Insecta bears one or two pairs of wings and some are wingless, while Arachnida and Crustacea are wingless. The only class Crustacea is found in water, while class Insecta and Arachnida, these are found on land. This slide shows the diseases transmitted by specific arthropods. So mosquito is responsible for transmission of malaria, filaria, Japanese encephalitis, dengue hemorrhagic fever, yellow fever, etc. Housefly is responsible for transmission of majority of the GI tract infections, conjunctivitis, trachoma, anthrax, yaws, etc. Sandfly transmits kalazar, sandfly fever. Tsetsefly transmits sleeping sickness. Louse is responsible for epidemic typhus, relapsing fever, pediculosis. Rat flea transmits bubonic plague, endemic typhus, shigellosis. Black fly transmits onchocerciasis. Reduvid bug causes Chagas disease. Hard tick is responsible for transmission of tick typhus, viral encephalitis, viral fever, tick paralysis, human babesiosis, etc. Soft tick is responsible for transmission of Q fever and relapsing fever. Trombiculid mite causes scrub typhus and rickettsial pox. Each mite causes scabies. Cyclops transmits guinea worm disease and fish tapeworm, and cockroaches are enteric pathogens. Out of these all, today we will be covering only mosquitoes, and the remaining part or remaining arthropods will be covering in the next lecture, that is entomology part 2. Before going into details of mosquito, we'll see some of the general principles of arthropod control which we can apply to control majority of the arthropods. And these are environmental control, chemical control, biological control, genetic control, use of personal protective measures, mechanical and physical control, and some of the newer methods. The environmental control is the best approach, as the results of these are likely to be permanent. Here, the main focus is to limit the vector breeding, survival, and limit the contact of the vectors with man. Here, some of the environmental manipulations can be elimination of breeding places, that is reduction of the source, filling and drainage operations, provision of piped water supply, proper disposal of refuse and other waste, maintaining cleanliness in and around house, etc. Next method is chemical control method, where you can use insecticides. These are the substances which are used to kill the insects. And based on the mechanism of action, the insecticides are classified into three groups. First one, contact poison, then stomach poison and fumigants. The contact poisons are those which kill the insects primarily by contact. Again, these are subclassified into two groups, natural and synthetic. In natural, pyrethrum extracts, nicotine and mineral oils. Then synthetic contact poisons, organochlorous compounds are there, for example DDT, methoxychlor, HCH, linden, etc. Then organophosphorus compounds like diazinon, malathion, parathion, phenthion, etc. Then repellents, which have repellent activity. These are metadiethyl toluamide, which is the content in Odomos. Then carbamates, carbaryl and propoxer, and synthetic pyrethroids, for example, resmethrin. Then coming to the stomach poison. Stomach poison are those which when ingested cause the death of the insect. There are two members in stomach poison, Paris green, that is copper acetoarsenide, and sodium fluoride. And the third group of the insecticide is fumigants. The fumigants are those which give off the vapors which have a lethal effect on the insects. And the fumigants are hydrogen cyanide, sulfur dioxide, carbon disulfide. Though chemical control is the most commonly used method to control the vectors, the insecticide resistance is the major problem with the use of these insecticides. And again, the use of insecticide is restricted because of the environmental contamination, which can be avoided by replacing the highly persistent compounds with readily biodegradable and less toxic products. For example, DDT can be replaced by methoxychlor, abate, etc. There may be a question on insecticide resistance, which is defined as the development of an ability in a strain of insects to tolerate doses of toxicants which would prove lethal to the majority of the individuals in a normal population of the same species. For example, DDT resistance in the housefly mosquitoes and body louse. The various factors that favor the development of the resistance are frequency of application, dosage and persistence of the insecticide, rate of reproduction of the arthropods, and population isolation. There are various methods to manage the resistance. For example, by rotation of the insecticides, then using mixture of insecticides at their optimum dosage, but ensure the efficacy and persistence of the two insecticides being mixed should be broadly similar, and fine scale mosaic, where you can use two insecticides in different houses in the same village. Next method of vector control is biological control, which is intentional manipulation of populations of living beneficial organisms called natural enemies in order to reduce the numbers of pests or amount of damage. For example, larvivorous fish like Gambusia affinis, Poecilia reticulata for mosquito control, and again you can use fungi of genus Coelomyces for mosquito control. Next is genetic control, which is defined as the use of any condition or treatment that can reduce the reproductive potential of nauseous forms by altering or replacing the hereditary material. Some of these techniques are sterile male technique, cytoplasmic incompatibility, and chromosomal translocations, which have been found to be effective in small field trials. All of you are familiar with the next method of vector control, that is personal protective measures. So these are used to prevent the arthropod vector from biting and feeding on its host and thereby blocking the chain of transmission of this disease from one host to another. Here we can use protective clothing like wearing long trousers, rolling down sleeves of shirts, socks, shoes, and particularly this when going outside the home. Then again, you can use repellents, which are the chemicals which repel the insects when applied to the body surface or clothing. For example, benzyl benzoate, then DEET, that is NN diethyl amptoleamide, etc. So you might have used Odomos, which is a repellent. Then use of mosquito nets. Again, that mosquito nets, they can be untreated or treated with insecticides. Next method is mechanical and physical control. Here we can use fly swatters, fly traps for house fly control. Just you can see in this picture, this is electric fly swatter and this is mechanical fly swatter. Then use of lice combs, glue traps for various pests like cockroaches and rodents. Again, other mechanical trapping devices can be used for other vectors. Some of the newer methods are also tried for the vector control, like biorational insecticides. Here, biorational means any substance of natural origin that has a lethal effect on the specific target pest. Some of the biorational insecticides are insect growth regulators, which regulate the growth and development of the insect. These are of two types: chitinous synthesis inhibitors and juvenile hormone mimics. Then next is pheromones, which are sex attractants and biocides. We have to avoid total dependence on any one method of vector control, as they may not be effective. So instead, we have to use integrated approach of vector control, that is integrated vector control or integrated vector management, which is the integral part of National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program and is defined as the utilization of all appropriate technological and management techniques to bring about an effective degree of vector suppression in a cost-effective manner. Simply, it consists of combining two or more methods of vector control with a view to obtain maximum results with minimum efforts and to avoid excessive use of any one method. And this approach requires a broad knowledge of vector biology, ecology, and behavior. So why there is need of integrated approach? As we have seen, because of the use of insecticides, there is development of insecticide resistance, some financial problems with the cost of newer insecticides, some environmental problems like environmental pollution due to the use of insecticides, and lack of public cooperation for the spraying of insecticides in their houses. This figure is of integrated vector management. Here we can see there are various methods of vector control, like source reduction, which is a part of environmental control. Though this is permanent method, it takes time. So you can support this with biological control, like using larvivorous fish. Again, you can support this with chemical control, that is use of various insecticides, then use of personal protection like using mosquito nets and repellents. Though it is temporary, it gives quick result. And most important is giving health education to communities, school children through mass media. So here, we instead of using only one method, like instead of using only environmental control or instead of using only biological control, we are combining the methods of vector control so as to ensure the maximum efficacy or maximum control of vectors so as to prevent the vector-borne diseases. Now we'll see all the arthropods one by one. As I have told you earlier, in this lecture I'll cover only mosquitoes and the remaining arthropods will cover in next lecture, that is in entomology part 2. Starting with the mosquitoes. So mosquitoes, these are the arthropods from class Insecta. Starting with the life cycle of mosquitoes. So life cycle of mosquitoes has 4 stages. First one is egg, then larva, then pupa, and pupa converts to adult. The egg stage of mosquito lasts for 1 to 2 days. Larval stage lasts for 5 to 7 days. Pupa stage lasts for 1 to 2 days and adult lives for 2 weeks. So total life cycle from egg to adult, it is completed in 7 to 10 days. Mosquitoes lay the eggs on the water surface and at a time they can lay up to 100 to 250 eggs. Some of the mosquitoes lay the eggs singly and some of the mosquitoes lay the eggs in bunch. Under favorable conditions, this stage will last for 1 to 2 days. The eggs are either of boat shaped with lateral floats or they are of cigar shaped. Usually, female needs a blood meal before it lays down the eggs. Next is larval stage. The larva of mosquito, it is a free swimming creature with an elongated body divisible into head, thorax and abdomen. Usually this larva feeds on algae, bacteria and vegetable matter and passes through 4 stages called as instars with a mold between each stage. This stage usually lasts for 5 to 7 days. Next is pupa, which is a comma shaped in appearance with large rounded cephalothorax as you can see here and narrow abdomen. There are 2 small respiratory tubes or also called as trumpets which project from the upper surface of the thorax as you can see here. These are the trumpets. And pupa, it is in resting stage of the mosquito and it lasts for 1 to 2 days. Then comes the adult stage. So after the development is complete, the pupal skin ruptures along the back and the adult or also called as imago emerges. It usually rests for some time for the wings to expand and then flies off and it lives for about 2 weeks. But again, it depends on the climatic conditions. And under favorable conditions, the whole life cycle of the mosquito is completed in 7 to 10 days. Here you can see the life history of mosquito. So you can see the egg, larva and pupa. These 3 stages of mosquito life cycle are in water. So eggs are laid on the water surface and larva and pupa, these are in the water while adult emerges in the air or land. As you know, mosquito belongs to the class Insecta. The body of the mosquito is divided into head, thorax and abdomen. The head, it is a semi-globular in outline. You can see in this picture, it is a semi-globular in outline. It bears a pair of compound eyes. Then there is one central needle-like structure that is called as proboscis with the help of which mosquito bites. Then on either side of this proboscis, a pair of palpi is there. Then a pair of antenna or feelers which are bushy in male and not quite so in the female. Then thorax. It is a thorax bears a pair of wings dorsally and there are three pairs of legs ventrally, which is a distinctive feature of class Insecta. Then abdomen, it has 10 segments, the last two of which are modified to form the external genitalia. In practical, you have to identify whether the mosquito slide is of male mosquito or female mosquito. So, based on the bushiness of antennae, we can identify whether it is male mosquito or female mosquito. As you can see here, in case of male, antennas are densely haired and look like mustache. While in case of female, these are not that much bushy and these are sparsely haired. This is the main difference between the male and female mosquito. Male mosquito antennas are more bushy and in case of female mosquito, less bushy antennae. Now, in practical, you have to distinguish between the three genera, that is Anopheles, Aedes and Culex. So we'll see the now we'll see the difference between the Anopheline and Culicine. So first stage of life cycle of mosquito is eggs. So Anopheline mosquito is the family Anopheline. It contains only one genus, that is Anopheles, while family Culicine contains three genera, that is Culex, Aedes and Monsonia. Here the difference between the eggs of Anopheline and Culicine are, in case of Anopheles mosquito, eggs are laid singly, while in case of Culicine, the eggs are laid in clusters or rafts, each raft containing 100 to 250 eggs. The exception is Aedes mosquito, where the eggs are laid singly. And second difference is eggs of Anopheles mosquito, these are boat shaped. You can see here the Anopheles mosquito eggs, these are boat shaped with lateral floats. This transparent part, these are the lateral floats. Means boat shaped egg with lateral floats is the characteristic feature of Anopheles mosquito egg. Then in case of Culex, the eggs are either cigar shaped or oval shaped and these are not provided with lateral floats. Here you can see the Culex, these are cigar shaped without any lateral float and these are seen in rafts. While in case of Aedes, these are laid singly without any lateral float. Next is the difference between larvae of Anopheline and Culicine mosquito. As you know, the larva, it is a free swimming creature under the water. The larva of Anopheles mosquito, it rests parallel to the water surface. As you can see in this picture, this is water surface and this is Anopheles larva which is swimming parallel to the water surface. Next is Culicine larva which is suspended with head downwards at an angle to the water surface. You can see it clearly in this picture. This is Culex larva which is suspended at an angle to the water surface with head downwards. This is head part, this is tail part. Okay, next difference is there is no siphon tube in case of Anopheles larva. You can see in the next second picture, this is Anopheles larva, this is head part and this is tail part. So there is no siphon tube in case of Anopheles larva. And siphon tube is present in Culicine. As you can see in this picture, this is head part of Aedes larva, abdomen and this is tail part. And this black structure, this is siphon tube. Again, you can see in this Culex larva, head part, tail part and elongated structure, that is siphon tube. siphon tube. Next difference is palmate hairs are present on abdominal segment of the larva of Anopheles mosquito, while there are no palmate hairs on Culicini larva. Next is the difference between pupa of Anopheline and Culicini. The pupa is comma shaped structure. So the difference is, in case of Anopheles pupa, the siphon tube, which is also called as trumpet, it is broad and short, while in case of Culicini, the siphon tube is long and narrow. Remember, in case of pupa of both Anopheline as well as Culicini, siphon tube is present, but the only difference is siphon tube of Anopheles is short and broad, while siphon tube of Culicini is long and narrow. Coming to the difference between adults of Anopheline and Culicini, first difference is, when at rest, the body of the Anopheles mosquito, it is inclined at an angle to the surface, while when at rest, the body of the Culicini mosquito, it exhibits a hunchback. Next difference is, wings are spotted in case of Anopheles mosquito, while wings are unspotted in case of Culicini mosquito. The main next difference is, the palpi in both the sexes of Anopheles mosquito are longer. You can see in this picture, Anopheline male mosquito, his head part, this is central needle like structure called as proboscis, and on either side maxillary palpi are there. Same here, head part, proboscis and maxillary palpi. So these are of somewhat equal length, means palpi and proboscis are of somewhat equal length in case of Anopheline in both the sexes. But in case of Culicini male, the maxillary palpi are longer than proboscis, while in case of female Culicini, the maxillary palpi are shorter than proboscis, means the palpi are of unequal length in the male and female. Remember, in case of Anopheline, length of proboscis and palpi is of somewhat equal, while in Culicini it is unequal. In case of male Culicini, palpi are longer than proboscis, while in female, palpi are shorter than proboscis. And this difference you can see in the slide, and that you can write as identifying point. Here you can see the Anopheles mosquito. This is female Anopheles head part. This is male Anopheles head part. The antennas in case of male Anopheles, these are more bushy, but in case of female, these are less bushy. Then proboscis and palpi are of somewhat equal length in both the sexes. One more difference between the male and female Anopheles is that in case of male Anopheles, the ends of the maxillary palpi are club shaped, but in case of female Anopheles, these are plain. This is Culicini female. As you can see, this is head part, central needle like structure, this is proboscis, and on either side of proboscis, maxillary palpi are there. So these are shorter than proboscis in case of Culicini female, and you can see antennae, these are less bushy. This is Culicini male slide. This is head part, this is proboscis, and on either side maxillary palpi are there, which are longer than proboscis. So this is proboscis and maxillary palpi are longer than proboscis, and antennae, these are more bushy. Again, this feature you can see in the slide. Here you can see the resting position of anophilini and culicini. In case of anopheles, as you know, the body of the anopheles, when at rest, it is at an angle to the surface. But in case of culicini, it exhibits hunchback when at rest. You can see it clearly in this picture. This is hunchback. Then body. So you can see the, in case of anopheles, the wing, only wings are spotted. Remember, only wings of the anopheles mosquito are spotted. While in case of Aedes, there are alternate white bands are there all over the body. Due to this, the Aedes mosquito is also called as tiger mosquito. And this is Culex. The Culex mosquito does not have any spots over the body nor over the wings. Now coming to the habits of mosquitoes, which will help us to control the mosquito. So first is feeding habit. Usually only females bite, so these are hematophagous, because they require a blood meal once in 2 to 3 days for development of eggs. But males never bite. Then time of biting. Usually majority of the mosquitoes bite at the evening time or at the early part of night. Some have day biting habit, for example Aedes mosquito. Then resting habit. During the daytime, indoor dark places or outdoor tree holes or shrubs are favored by the mosquitoes for resting. Next is about breeding habit. So anophilini generally prefer clean water. Okay, they usually prefer clean water. Culicini prefers dirty and polluted water. Dirty, stagnant and polluted water is favored by Culex mosquito. Aedes mosquito prefers the artificial collections of water. Because of this, the Aedes mosquito is also called as container mosquito, because it breeds in artificial containers. Like you can see, the nutshells are there, then tires, broken buckets, etc. Then the Monsoonia breed in water containing certain types of aquatic vegetation. So remember, Culex breeds in stagnant and dirty water. Aedes, it is a container mosquito which breeds in the artificial collection of water, and Anophilini prefers clean water. Then dispersal of mosquito. So mosquito, it can fly up to 11 kilometers. So Aedes aegypti flies within 100 meters. So all the airports and seaports are kept free from mosquitoes up to 400 meters around the perimeter of ports. Then lifespan, it varies between 8 to 34 days and is influenced by both temperature and humidity. Now coming to the diseases transmitted by mosquito. So Anopheles, the genus Anopheles transmits malaria. Genus Aedes transmits yellow fever, dengue, dengue hemorrhagic fever, chikungunya hemorrhagic fever, Rift Valley fever and Zika virus. While the Culex mosquito is responsible for transmission of Bancroftian filariasis, Japanese encephalitis, West Nile fever and viral arthritis. There can be a question on this. Diseases transmitted by mosquitoes. Now we'll see the control measures for mosquitoes. So control measures, it can be divided into anti-larval measure, anti-adult measure and protection against mosquito bites. Okay, so in anti-larval measures, as we have seen in general control of arthropods, here the environmental control, chemical control and biological control in anti-adult measures, residual sprays, space sprays, and genetic control. Then protection against mosquito bite, you can use mosquito net, screening, and repellents. We'll see one by one. So in anti-larval measures, the environmental control, as all of you have seen in the general control of arthropods, the environmental control means reduction in the source and comprises minor engineering methods such as filling, labeling, and drainage of breeding places and water management. Okay, but again it depends on the genus of mosquito. For example, if the anopheliny is the major problem, their breeding places should be looked for and abolished by appropriate engineering measures such as filling and drainage. Then if Culex mosquitoes are the problem, then abolition of domestic and peri-domestic sources of breeding such as cesspools and open ditches, and arrangement should be made for adequate collection, removal, and disposal of sewage and wastewater. As all of us know, the Culex mosquito breeds in dirty stagnant water. Then if Aedes mosquitoes are the problem, and the breeding places of Aedes mosquitoes are the artificial water containers, so environment should be cleaned up and got rid of water holding containers such as discarded tins, empty pots, broken bottles, coconut shells, and similar other artificial collections of water. If Monsoonia is the major problem, so the aquatic plants to which the larva of the Monsoonia attaches themselves should be removed or destroyed by herbicides. Second anti-larval measure is chemical control, means use of various insecticides. You can use mineral oils like diesel oil, fuel oil, kerosene oil, and special form mosquito larvicidal oil. The dose of which should be 40 to 90 liters per hectare once a week. And when applied on water, the oil spreads and forms a thin film which cuts off the air supply to the mosquito larvae and pupa, and it will kill the larva. Next, you can use Paris green or copper acetoarsenide, which is one of the stomach poison, and it can be used in the form of dust, that is 2% of the dust, and dose is 1 kg per hectare. Then you can use synthetic insecticides like Fenthion, Chlorpyrifos, and Abet. Here, Abet is the only insecticide that can be used in drinking water sources also. So the dose of this Abet is 56 to 112 gram per hectare. Dose of the Malathion is 220 to 670 grams per hectare. Fenthion dose 22 to 112 gram per hectare. For Chlorpyrifos, the dose is 11 to 16 gram per hectare. The next anti-larval measure is biological control. Here we can use Gambusia affinis and Lebister reticulatus, which are larvivorous fish. The larvivorous efficiency of Gambusia is due to the fact that the single full-grown fish can eat about 100 to 300 mosquito larvae per day. So these can be used in burrow pits, sewage oxidation pond, ornamental ponds, and farm ponds. Now coming to the anti-adult measures for control of the mosquitoes, we can use residual sprays, space sprays, and genetic control. The residual sprays means these insecticides have residual action. For example, DDT, which is applied at the dose of 1 to 2 gram per square meter, and its residual action lasts up to 6 to 12 months. Then Linden, which is BSC, benzene hexachloride, pure benzene hexachloride, it is applied at the dose of 0.5 gram per meter square and its residual action is up to 3 months. Then malathion 2 gram per meter square, again 3 months of residual action. AMS 33 2 gram per meter square, again it has 3 months of residual action. Means for DDT you have to reapply the DDT insecticide after 6 months, and for lindane, malathion and OMS 33 you have to repeat the insecticide after 3 months. Then you can also use space sprays like pyrethrum extracts. Here the insecticidal formulations are sprayed into the atmosphere in the form of mist or fog to kill the insects. The pyrethrum extract, here it is a nerve poison and it has no residual action. The dosage is 1 ounce of the spray solution containing 0.1% of the pyrethrin, which is the active principle of pyrethrum extract, per 1000 cubic feet of space. Again, in space sprays, some of them have a residual insecticide, a residual action, for example malathion and phenytrothione. Then genetic control, here these are in research phase. Here we can use sterile male technique, cytoplasmic incompatibility, chromosomal translocation, sex distortion and gene replacement. Here the first picture shows the residual spraying on the wall. Here you can use DDT, lindane or malathion, which has residual action up to 6 and 3 months respectively. So again, this residual action depends on the quality of, depends on the type of the wall, whether it is pakka wall or kaccha wall. If it is kaccha wall or made up of mud, the residual action is less. And in this next, in second picture, it is space spraying. Here you can use pyrethrum extract or malathion. Next is protection against mosquito bites, where you can use mosquito nets, screening of the buildings and the use of repellents. The mosquito net, the material of the net should be white so as to identify the mosquitoes, and the hole size of the mosquito net should be less than 0.0475 inch in diameter, and the number of holes in 1 square inch should be 150. Again, there are insecticide treated bed nets or ITNs, which are treated with synthetic pyrethroids like deltamethrin. So, but the problem with this insecticide treated bed nets is that you have to repeat the or retreat the bed net for 4 to 6 months. Means after every 6 months you have to retreat the bed net. So next is, next advancement in insecticide treated bed net is long lasting nets. So there is no need to retreat the net up to 4 to 5 years. For example, Olicet net, which is treated with 2% permethrin, then Permanet, which is treated with deltamethrin at the rate of 50 mg per square meter. The next method of protection against mosquito bite is screening the buildings by using copper or bronze gauze, 16 mesh to an inch. It is costly, but it gives excellent results. Again, the size of the hole, same as mosquito net, that should be less than 0.0475 inch diameter. Then again, you can use various repellents like DEET, which is diethyl toluamide, dimethyl phthalate, dimethyl carbate, indalone and ethyl hexanidol. Here the diethyl toluamide, it is available as a brand name as Mosfree and Odomos, that you might have used. Here we can see some of the personal protective measures like using mosquito coils, using mosquito bed nets, then screening the buildings with the help of copper or bronze mesh, then using repellents like Odomos. So just to summarize what we have seen in this lecture, so first we saw some of the definitions like what is entomology, what is medical entomology, what is arthropod, what is vector, etc. Then we saw classification of arthropods, then arthropod borne diseases with arthropods responsible for their transmission, then general principles of arthropod control. In that we saw environmental control, biological control, chemical control, genetic control, personal protective measures and some of the newer methods. Then again we saw integrated vector management. So there can be one LAQ over this integrated vector management. Then we saw mosquitoes, in that life cycle of mosquito, difference between Anopheline and Culicine, habits of mosquito, diseases transmitted by mosquitoes and control measures for mosquito. So see you in the next lecture with remaining part of entomology. Thank you.